More strategy?
Get a little bit more formal. I'm going to go with yes. That is one thing I can. As a play-by-play caster, I can confirm that.
Okay.
We're jumping into the game. Dignitas versus TDK here. Our final game of week two, day one. Evelyn and Gnar have already found themselves on the bench for this one, as well as Nidalee. Let's see what the last two for each team are here. Going quite quick. They know what they want to get off the board for this game.
Yeah, that's two junglers targeted at Kez, but the Nidalee is also a flex ban against Seraph in the top lane because he plays that. He plays it full AD, but we're not going to see it this game. And I like the fact that Dignitas took away a lot of key junglers from Kez that he has early game aggression on. And then the Rek'Sai ban from TDK, that's a little bit surprising, but they don't want a Zhongli on that. He's going to get the Gragas, though.
Whoa.
Which is, this always blows my mind when you ban one of the early game junglers that everybody fears and you leave up the other one just be first pick. But they left up the Ryze, and that's the bait here and the deliberation.
Does Gamsu take it? He has seen himself on a Hecarim and a Gnar so far. The Hecarim is open, but right now with the strength of Ryze, what he can do in team fights and the safeness.
I just love this music.
Why this wouldn't be a pickup. It's an it makes each pick so epic.
Will he lock it in? We'll see in a few minutes.
And that is going to be a Ryze in the top lane and up against Seraph, who right now is the strongest member on TDK in terms of performance that we've seen in the past. And now he's up against this monster of a champion in this current patch that can just roll over him, and he has to play this safe. And I want to see what Seraph has up his sleeve against this champion.
So he said top laners are kind of on an island with their tanks. Well, their variety comes here in the spring split of 2015. And it looks like the variety stays up. Seraph will not take the top pick so far. Looks like he wants to see the rest of the team before they actually give him a power pick, if he can still grab it. It's the Gragas and the Nautilus picked up here on the side of Team Dragon Knights. Well,
they get their Gragas. They give up the Ryze, though. And if they have something prepared for this, then it's definitely the right way to go about it. Gragas does have a way to get in onto the Ryze from ganks and throw him into the team. And that would, I guess, be the weakness of this champion, since he likes to stay at arm's length.
Yeah.
Just destroy you with roots.
There is the Zac coming in as well. Arm's length. Gragas is at belly's length.
The Rek'Sai ban, the Evelyn ban, the Nidalee, the Gragas takeaway. It's really no hair off Zhongli's chest here because he's just going to go back to the Zac.
That's something I was going to say as well. Who's ever going to ban his favorite champion that he continuously plays over and over? We saw against CLG, he did try the Sejuani, but from past season in the summer at the end there to now, it's been Zac. Zac is his love pick. Gets it in this time. Kalista as well. We'll see who Kiwi Kid's going to be thrown around as with the Fates call for this composition. The Annie's still left up. Pretty for sure pick for these guys. Allows Kiwi Kid to get in or out, whether he has flash or not.
Yeah, and they picked the Kalista up. Surprised they didn't go with the Sivir here, but this is going to be dissuading TDK from picking the Sivir for this composition, because if you look at it, Sivir would go great with these champions that want to get in there and want to tackle that Ryze. But the Kalista-Sivir matchup, like Double If said, he got lucky in it, was able to outplay it, but it's 80-20
in favor.
Said he
should have been pushed in. Heard it from the man himself. Aurelia and Corki are both locked in. This could be a mid Corki as well if Pichu wants to take that. Aurelia towards the top lane, and we have that jungle Nautilus, or I'm sorry, support Nautilus, jungle Gragas. Core JJ has the Kalista, and they quickly lock in the Morgana. Interesting.
We did see an Aurelia against a Ryze earlier today. Aurelia can do well in that matchup due to her tenacity, the fact that she can get in on Ryze. It's not the same matchup that it used to be, though. Aurelia used to fare much better in it, but now that Ryze has a shield, he has a way to trade effectively.
Yeah.
And ooh, this is actually a very, this is very interesting because we've seen mid lane Aurelia into Azir a couple times. Azir's locked in, Aurelia is still on the table. Sounds a little crazy to say, but we've seen it twice now throughout the world. I want to see if Bishu takes this Aurelia into the Azir from Shifter.
I feel like Bishu would be the one to do it pretty high mechanically. It's the team fighting that usually takes down a sub-squad. The solo lanes in the early game usually go pretty steady still for teams that are subbing out more than a few players. And TDK here looking to lock in their last one to round out the composition. They may just go with the double AD.
Yep.
They do decide to. That's an Aurelia in top lane. Again, we get a mid lane Varus now from Bishu and that Corki for Latman. So they decide the double AD comp is the way to go.
Yep, been running into Bishu in solo queue a lot. It's pretty much been Azir Varus for him for a while now. His Varus is actually, from what I was seeing, pretty deadly And the fact he's going to play it into this Azir. Azir is not going to have a lot of threat onto the Varus during the laning phase. It's going to be in Varus' favor for most of it. I keep swapping between Varus and Varus every time I say it. It's going to be a different name. But you can see TDK's composition once again. Double AD. They do have a lot of wave clear here. And then it's going to be Seraph split pushing. This is a team designed to split push and wave clear and siege with four people and then have Seraph TP in later. And then if you look over at Dignitas's composition, this is a little bit of team fight and it's a little bit all over the place. Late game is the name of the game for Dignitas right now. Get Kiwi Kid out of lane on Morgana, affect these lanes, try to snowball them, try to team fight after that, and that's the strat right there for them.
It's the man Rico on your screen. Coach Sean for Team Dragon Knights will head to the back. They've said the last words to their team.
Ever.
In just a few minutes. Hopefully they're shaking their hands due to a victory. The teams have locked in their champion. So start sending us your picks for this game. Tweet at LOL Esports with the hashtag DIGWin or the hashtag TDKWin. We'll update the fan poll with your votes shortly as we head into the game. Final game here, week two, day one. We're going to get Team Dragon Knights versus Team Dignitas, and we are on the Rift.
Like I said, I want to keep eyes on the junglers this game, Azingi and Kez. Who can open up their team? Because Dignitas' composition, if a kill falls into any of these laners' hands early on, it is a gift from Azingi. Because if you get that Ryze going, you get that you get that Azir off the ground, you let that Kalista get closer to her two-item spike, the game is going to get out of hand very quickly. TDK, though, they want a siege. They want to get some kills. They don't need them, but they have really good sieging capabilities. Only thing is, Azingi has a great champion for breaking sieges and starting the fights.
Oh, Gamsu getting found out. We'll see how he does on this Ryze as well, as we were just talking about Azingi looking to give him some help.
Nope. He's going to ward the back of it. Nobody's there to kill it. So he gets all that information that everybody from TDK is there.
You are a very dangerous man, Gamsu. He's going to back out, though. We'll see how he plays this Ryze. We do know he's been playing the Hecarim lately. He likes the Ignite Hecarim. A little bit of different style, but he should still be going with a W-level Ryze and then spam QE, QE. And then a few W's, and then QE, QE.
It's the Wakek combo.
The Wakek.
W, Q, E, Q, because that's what you say when you start running that combo, and you're like, Wakek, Wakek, Wakek. You sound like the Penguin from Batman.
Well, he has a wild.
That's at least how I remember it, because if you drop that combo just one spell in the wrong order, you end up dropping the whole thing, and you're not going to be able to keep them rooted in place forever.
That is true. If you do it wrong, you don't get the cooldowns you need, and they just kind of walk away from you. Nice clap he made it by.
That was like a golf clap. I was like,
it was. It was formal. It was a nice play. He squeaked himself by.
Jolly good squeak.
Jolly good. All right, so he gives no knowledge to TDK as they head to the top side. Looks like with a bit of a Raptor camp, Seraph's going to try to get himself a bit of a lead to whatever lane he goes in here. But Gamsu's going to be a little worried. Not seeing anything, but he probably won't care in a few seconds knowing he is alone. Kez takes his red to himself. Azingi didn't get too much help either, but they are off and running.
Yeah, it's just Seraph starting a camp. This is going to blow his teleport early on, though. It always leaves that tiny window in the first 7 minutes of the game where if Dignitas or the enemy team, whoever doesn't use their TP, they get an advantage and can throw it down to the bottom lane. So you always have to watch for shoves in the first 7 minutes and if Gamsu's going to enter a lane. Kez, though, he is so ready for this.
Very nicely done. Teleported to the top side. This was flipped last game. They were going after Kali Trolls after he blew his teleport. Now it's Seraph who blew his teleport going for the kill with Kez.
Is Kez going to keep waiting here?
See if they can get in. He's actually spent quite a bit of time. Just misses the body slam. Going to get a slow, but not enough for the surge in from Seraph. So knowledge of the jungler. A nice ward placed by Gamsu as well.
Yeah, Seraph started Q and E in his first two levels, just to try and make this gank happen. Kez, devoting a lot of his time to this top lane, doesn't get a second buff just yet for that level two, trying to get Seraph, the one person who's not on the sub squad alongside Kez, trying to get him ahead, trying to get that synergy down and that early advantage.
Definitely the lane aggression advantage here on the lat man in the bottom lane. We'll see how much of the CS he misses as it goes into the turret. Core JJ and Kiwi Kid were dancing on either side of their wave as they were pushing this in, trying to get damage down. Safe play we saw last game. Doesn't put you in the lead, Zyrene, so we'll see if TDK can try to prevent some of this quite soon. farming pretty well. Not too bad. Bring himself up to 16 out of the 22 that Core JJ has grabbed so far here 4 minutes into the game. So he's keeping himself on par. Just a little bit under their backs should be nearly the same. Bishu in the mid lane already took soldier damage here from Shifter. It looks like the consumables are going to keep him clearing those waves, actually. So no problem there as well. Just waiting for Kez to be able to muster up another gank since he was found out in the bot lane, or top lane, for his first.
Yeah, and then that put him behind in CS. You can see his Zing has been farming really well so far. He goes for the Bomby Cinder before he completes his jungle item, just so he can get some wards in his inventory as well.
Oops.
And some extra potions. And Kez, he goes straight for the jungle item, tries to clear out because he didn't get his second buff just yet. He's getting it now.
Off and running. Gromp will be his. Let's see his HP. He's actually got good HP. He made head towards the bottom lane.
Oh, for pressure. Oh, the soldier's like, come here.
He's just on the outside. Cannot get.
Actually happens in game too when you're playing Azir. It feels so strange when you're inputting so many commands and it starts
just swinging.
It starts freaking out like that. I'm like, is he in range? Did I get that auto?
My soldier's spazzing out. He's controlled a few already. Has made him chug all that flask so far.
I love it when it follows the guy around and kind of tracks him. It's like, you're just out of range. Just let me poke you.
Feel bad for it. But then he turns into sand and he'll come back later. You don't have to feel bad anymore.
I still feel bad about it.
Does it keep you awake at night?
Yes.
Lane pushing back in the favor of TDK here for just a bit. But I don't think Core JJ and Kiwi Kid are going to let that happen for them to farm. They're probably going to use this for aggression here soon.
Yeah, Bishu backed for the early tier on a non-cannon minion wave. So he loses a little bit of CS. Let's see if he can get his push on and shove it to the enemy turret before Shifter can actually get back there, or cause Shifter to use a little bit of his mana to actually come faster. But this is a good back by Shifter, because Shifter's going to have the cannon mini wave in his.
Another good play as well. Ward's on the top lane, spotting out Kez. He was seen at the tri-brush. Now the ping's coming in from Gamsu, sees the pink ward just above mid lane. Wow, Kez is not going to have fun this game. He is completely on the radar the entire time he's been jungling.
Yep. It's a predictable strategy, though, when you have three substitutes on your team. Which lane are you going to gank as the non-substitute jungler? Probably the guy you know best on the team.
Right. That's true. Definitely playing to that effect. It is 50-29 in that top lane.
He runs away just to run back. He's like, oh, you know what? We can still go for this.
Get his teleport up. Get him out of lane. They want to make sure that he is actually still hurt.
Shifter and Zingy are both on their way, though.
Very true. Gamsu's still getting his tier to stack throughout all this. He's still going to be Ryze. We saw as Huni picked it in the first time in the EU LCS, he actually had a pretty rough early game and still was ridiculous Huni coming out in the late game. Vizichachi also picking up the Ryze, seeing it more and more due to that late game fighting.
Yeah. This is amounting in a little bit of a CS lead here for Seraph. He did start that camp at level 1 and got the level 2 advantage.
That's true.
And they have the early gank and pressure on Gamsu. He didn't have to blow any summoners, but it still has amounted in pressure for Seraph and a CS advantage. Bishu, though, when Shifter left his lane just now, he didn't punish him. He just tried to freeze it. He had all six minions still in that wave by the time that Shifter came back. He didn't charge Q. He didn't try to shove it up and punish Shifter for that roam because he had no idea where he was going or that he had left.
Yeah. Bishu looking for farm as well as a bit of aggression here in the mid lane as he charges up that tier. Still being pushed back a bit, but good farming between both these guys. They will be very useful in the first fight here if neither of them can take each other out within the next few minutes. I don't think we're going to get jungle pressure here either. No worries for these two. Like you said, we'd see Bishu playing a little too safe, and Shifter just using soldiers as well. Nice hit there.
It's the poke back and forth. No, you go low. No, just back and forth, trying to get that advantage. Once again, both junglers top lane. The ward coverage, though, is in favor of Dignitas. They know this. They don't know Azingi's there, though.
Slingshot actually misses as Azingi says Jello.
They want to get on Gamsu.
I'm here. He should be able to make it out. Oh. Arcane Mastery coming up nicely to give him a bit of shield. And he's out safely.
Really nice by both teams there.
Yeah.
But that was TDK operating without information of Azingi's positioning and Seraph reacting very quickly. But the thing is, they didn't overlap their CCs. It was not, he is in Rune Prison while you have the Elastic shot coming down on top of him. There's a little bit of a lack of overlap of CC there that would have resulted in more damage.
See, this is a walkout. Gamsu is going ahead and waltz back to late. No teleport needed there. So still up for both him and Seraph. 9 minutes into the game now. About a 400 gold lead in favor of Team Dragon Knights. He's got to come out of the laning phase. A few CS here, a few CS there. And Core JJ has still been able to keep Latman down a few, but they're still doing a lot better than previous games. Latman and Baby in that bottle.
Yeah. Yeah, Latman and Baby, they've had some problems in the past against Team Liquid and Gravity. They didn't have the best of games, the best of bot lane times.
Yeah.
It was the worst of bot lane times.
Yeah, it could have been. Depends on how you look at it.
But right now, TDK slightly in the advantage. It's not really a big advantage that's worth talking about just yet, because the junglers, they still haven't gotten off the ground.
Yeah.
And when this is happening in the game and you have such a late game composition from both teams actually favor the late game right now, it's just going to be coming down to team fights and execution. And Shifter, in his little sound on tape we had earlier,
yeah,
he was talking about how they don't have good coordination. They don't have good team fighting. Maybe that's where Dignitas is aiming to hit TDK, waiting for that stage of the game, just trying to hold off, trying
right.
to team fight champions, and try to beat them there.
That's kind of what I was looking at for TDK as well, is where do they, you know, kind of go off the handle, or do they do what comes natural to them? Do they say, since we don't have too many strats, do we do things that we all normally do? We're okay at dragons, we know how to position around that. We're okay at protecting a buff, but maybe the tower dive won't work since the synergy's not there.
Oop.
How do they actually make it work? And right now, it's still the word defense. Stay
yep.
defensive. Nice hit by Shifter, trying to come in with a zingy there. Not too much came of it. Kez is going to Raptor pop a pink ward, unfortunately, but still clear some nice vision. That's been there for a long time, actually.
It has been there a very long time. Here comes a zingy.
Woo! Just missed. He's still got moves for a big guy.
Trying to keep the pressure up, trying to stay on this map and very relevant. Seraph, though, if Seraph gets ahead, he has a tendency to split push as much as possible.
He's already caught up pretty
Oh, they know that Kez is here, though. This is the route that he would take.
A Once
Zingy
again.
Off on the side, though.
Oh, like
here comes the collapse.
Rinse and repeat here on Dignitas top lane. Gamsu and a Zingy once again.
Hey, guys, what's up?
Oh, hip and hip, and they get out safely. You got to try something else soon. I don't know. Perseverance pays off. I got to credit for them to keep trying. But so far, they have come up with nothing. We're 11 and a half minutes and zero kills. And nobody really has even gone under half HP here. There was a hit on Gamsu, but he keeps getting out.
Yeah, and actually what I wanted to expand on the Seraph point was he has a tendency to split push. If he gets ahead at all over the rise and he has the capability of solo killing him,
yeah.
he will immediately push that. And that's what this composition wants to do. Like I talked about from Champions, like 4-1 split push with Seraph. Wave clear, siege with your double ADs, just poke people down, and then have Seraph TP in or get an advantage by solo killing. Dignitas, though, on the other hand, they want to stay safe, and the fact that Zingy is just counter ganking, blowing flashes mid, and trying to just have some pressure, some relevance, doesn't have to take over the game. But look at this Seraph, he's going in, he's a little too far.
Like you said, right when he thinks he has that idea
Kez.
That he can take down Gamsu, oh. they go right for him. He gets bounced out by the last hit, actually, of Zingy. And Kez does not get what he wants out of that ultimate. Shifter comes in with Shifting Sands. And Zingy picks up First Blood. Once again, has a hand in that for Dignitas. Something that helped them a lot against Cloud9. We'll see if Team Dignitas can keep it up.
And Seraph just ditched him.
Yeah, he was peaced.
He was like, I'm going to come help you. And oh. Nope. This is a tag in, but he took the bullet for him.
Quick pie to the face as you duck for your partner. So as they come up on 13 minutes, we finally get a little blood drawn. Shifter will make
Shifter can only take so many arrows.
Yeah, yeah. He got the assist, I should say, that kill going to a Zingy. Still going to get pushed into the lane, but hopefully he can help him out finishing a few more items.
Yeah. Bishu's a little too far forward, though. Zingy is off on the side, and there's no flash here. He's not going to go for this. He's going to just go for wave clear, because Shifter has no potions, and he's taking so much. Yeah. This is...
Hail of Arrows and an auto attack would be a dead Shifter right now.
Yeah.
Very close.
Even just Chain of Corruption. And like
that's that too.
Bopping him one time.
Just a quick bop. Make it
all it takes. Now he gets to shove the wave in. He gets to get a little bit of a CS advantage here. Clear the cannon as fast as possible. Get that back wave. Zingy might have to soak this wave for him.
Everything is happening at such random times for teams. Like, nobody's set anything up yet. That was back almost a good time for Dragon, but then Latman and Baby went back, so nobody was actually there for the side of TDK.
Shifter.
A lot is just what's on the map right now. They're trying to figure out what to do with where everyone is. Nothing planned.
Yeah, Shifter wants to stay on the map longer. He came back with 4 health potions because that's how much he's getting poked out of this lane. The fact that it's linear wave clear at the same time as poke from Varus, he's able to get this down, chunk him. Look at that, 1/3 of his HP. That's an HP pot right there. So basically, he can take 4 more arrows than he would have normally, or at least 3 more.
Oh, we might get our first
that's a lot of spears.
Dragon. Oh.
Don't go back in range of the red.
Quick passive jump and the flash, actually, to get out of that anchor toss. Baby's going to try and get some brush control, but it's not going to get him anywhere. They're just making sure they're actually safe in this bot lane themselves. Pings over to the side of Dragons from Team Dignitas. They say, can we actually get some pressure onto this?
It's a little risky. Bishu hasn't backed yet. Shifter just freshly
wants
backed.
It.
Yeah, Bishu's
just the movement. Very nice play from Team Dignitas here.
Yeah.
Just to say, hey, of course we know, and you're definitely going to have to fight us if you want to try. So kind of flexing their muscles. Nobody gets the dragon just yet, but that does mean we are going to get the full 5v5 fight. No one gets picked off. Not too much jungler intervention has really helped TDK. Azingi's first try coming over on the bait from Gamsu, coming up nicely with a rotation kill from Shifter in the mid lane. So those guys have a little bit to start this. It looks like they're resting on that gold right now, not pressuring too much.
Kez is actually coming down bottom lane now. They set this up with a pink ward.
Making sure, that they can't see him.
It's still
all right.
Oh, black shield.
Depth charge. There it is. Fate's Call, pulled right out. So many options, variables to get themselves out of the fight. And only one flash had to be blown there to make sure Core JJ didn't get into too much of a dangerous position. So another attempt by TDK, unfortunately, does not work towards the bottom lane.
Yep. Despite being down a kill, though, they are up in gold
overall,
just based off of CS.
Making the lanes work.
From Seraph and from Bishu in the mid lane. So everybody's, it's kind of like what CLG was doing, except not to that extent, where everybody's just having a better laning phase. Bishu, he still hasn't backed yet, but he needed this blue buff very desperately, because when you bring 4 health potions back to the lane like Shifter did, that takes a toll on your mana pool as as a poker, because you keep throwing out these Qs, and it's like, okay, I need to throw out 4 more Qs to get through his life pool to the same point that I would have before. But now I still have the same amount of mana. So now that he has this blue buff on him, it's a good time for Bishu to continue this poke pattern. He won't have to back for a while, but he's sitting on 1,600 gold.
Oh! Ah!
Yeah.
Please stop. Oh, I can feel that. Wow, big damage to Bishu. Shifter comes back with a Morel and Namakan. Ability tome on that as well. Does not look like they are going to be able to stop him anytime soon. Already putting soldiers down in the turret. Forced by Bishu to clear out those Qs. Like you said, going back to spend that 1,600 some gold, so he'll be away from lane. Actually,
he's not. He doesn't want
to. He wants one more shot out.
He doesn't want to. He wants to stay there as long as possible.
Got the blue. Why not?
And keep this pattern. Look at that.
How? It's like right on the end every time.
You think you got him shoved out of the wave, but you don't. Yep.
Aww.
Ooh.
Almost. He's still up, though. 164 there being pushed.
He's still going to. Is he going to stay?
Finally gets a chance to back.
Okay.
He's got to go.
He's going to go.
He used all that blue in lane, so I guess it doesn't matter anymore. It's going to be worn off. Dragon is ready to be taken down. They have the back on Morgue.
They just saw her.
Yeah.
This is a great time to converge onto the dragon here from TDK.
Zingy with the flyby. I want to see it.
Also,
he's back.
Another part of this, if a fight does break out, Bishu just purchased Brutalizer and his Ioni Boots of Lucidity, has a lot of cooldown. So if this does break into a 5v5 fight, it's going to be in favor of TDK. And now Shifter, he backs, so it's definitely going over to TDK uncontested.
It's going to be a little bit of pain. 4.8 seconds for each one of those piercing arrows to come out. And right now, they're hitting for pretty good damage. Over 300, so not going to be something you'll be wanting to take too much of.
300 to 500.
325, so probably that 500.
Depending on how many things it's passed through as well.
Slamming Shifter in the face when he charges up a full one that we've been seeing here in the mid lane. Now that he's got more damage, Shifter's going to have to be even more careful. Needlessly large rod for him, so he can start to output a little bit of DPS as well on top of what we already saw. Very aggressive movements here from the bot lane. One binding or one anchor toss seems like it could really turn the tide here. Both teams are looking for those abilities.
And while all that dragon was going down, Bishu just shoved mid lane up, Shifter backed, and they got that turret for themselves.
Mm-hmm.
That's extra gold in the pocket of TDK. And the sub squad pulling out some moves today. pretty much just staying safe. But look at this. Oh, we got another one.
What a crazy interaction. A flash out from Latman. Didn't have the Valkyrie since he already used
it. Here's
Kez. Kiwi Kid low, takes a shot, but he's going to stay alive. Latman did not have a big rocket loaded up.
Aw, Kez, be a man. Flash throw the barrel, kill him. Could have done it. But no. Kez is going to go with the reserved play because that's very punishable. Blow your flag, look at this. Oh, Seraph. Oh.
Here's the
turn,
rise.
Turn away.
WQE. Can I open my eyes yet?
Yeah. Well,
okay.
You can look, Rip.
Okay,
I had to save you from that.
It looks like nothing happened. That's fine with me.
You're so innocent, young. I don't want you to see that.
Why does it happen so quickly? 20 minutes on the clock. Seraph finds out what the rise can do, even if you hold him down a little bit by 30 CS in lane. 101 now as Gamsku starts to take over that lane, solo style. Even pressured by Kez for a long time.
Oh, it's a 30 CS advantage, just Trinity Force completed.
And yeah.
Now he's like, okay, I gotta get Merktres.
The pain game.
Because
baby.
What just happened? You weren't gonna show it again? Why?
Boom. So he ults Arcane Mastery Shield, so Seraph can't even come back in. And just the one. The thing that. Actually, Seraph could have done was keep in the minions, because then he cannot continuously queue you, and that's one thing that goes against if you're fighting a wave against Ryze.
It lowers the damage that you take,
you're still
but you're
getting
still,
it. Right.
Yeah,
you're still getting his cooldown.
I'm glad there was no sound of that, because we got to hear no evil that time. Oh, man.
It's the little things. You might take a bit of damage, but you won't take the full. Oh, dear.
I won't die. But I'll be very uncomfortable for 6 seconds.
Or hopefully you
standing in the same
get
spot.
Out of range and don't take it at all and the minions take it. It's painful. It's definitely hard. You can see that even with the tenacity, Seraph not able to get out of that situation. Merc treads on top of the Triforce for him. Already the Aegis being built up here by Kez. He knows the pain factor coming in. Shifter is pretty big in the mid lane. And Gamsu is only going to wreak havoc along with Kiwi Kid's ultimates and bindings to start off these fights.
Dignitas solely needed that, though, because that shuts down Seraph's whole I'm going to split push you to death because, they first picked a rise against us because we left it open.
Mm-hmm.
And now he's going to possibly take over the game. He's at least going to take over that lane until Seraph gets assistance.
And look at all that focus Kez put up there. Gamsu gets it to work for himself, even with that aggression. Strong play from each individual member of this season. It's really not one person kind of going off here for Dig, and it seems the team comes together much better.
They're coming down bottom now from TDK. Bishu on his way. Kez finds this ward because they saw Shifter go up, and now you can see.
They seem like they want this.
They want this turret, and that's going to be Seraph holding mid lane. They give up a little bit of CS top, but Seraph, he still has a way to get back up there. They're just looking for a fight. TDK trying to rotate and allocate members to different parts of the map. You can see back up. Bishu's like, all right, let's go back. Where'd my CS go? Seraph, what are you doing?
Ooh. All right.
It makes sense.
I feel like that was a bit of an unnecessary move.
Well, if Azingi had flashed the other side of him and Let's Bounce, it would have knocked him 500 units
towards
where Shifter was.
Kind of the reason to engage him to have to flash in the first place. I don't think Bishu really needed to do that. Well. Hopefully it doesn't cost him too much in the next fight if he does need to flash. You have quite a bit of things that can close a gap on you. 59-41 here. Team Dignitas taking over on the vote here from social media as well.
Yeah, TDK haven't really established themselves too much.
Mm-hmm.
Trying to get some hype, though, around Emperor and Ninja next week.
Yeah.
See what they can do for the team. Right now, though, TDK having some good play across the map. Those rotations to get that bottom turret. They gave up the top turret, though, to Gamsu.
Yeah.
And now they're going to give up this middle turret. Just some damage, though. Kez is here to clear it up. Seraph. Oh, okay. So they lane swapped their AD carry into a lane where they can get a different turret. Seraph's going to try to hold this. Basically, he's saying, we should have done this from the start of the game. Screw Ryze. He doesn't want to be in that lane anymore. Sorry, I'm very passionate about Ryze right now. This is why!
Passionate
indeed,
baby! Oh, he goes down. Now on to Latman. WQE, do it again! Gamsu actually has to turn. The combo wasn't finished off on that time, and you can see just a few seconds what it means for Ryze to have to turn around if that combo is not consecutively made out. He tries to keep it going, finally gets locked down again. It's one after the other of TDK getting themselves into that turret aggro and back out. And they come up nicely with a few kills as they lose baby.
But they're losing so much
and
for this.
They're losing
they lost
middle.
The mid, and they're losing the tier 2 down bottom to Core JJ, who has a Bloodthirster, 2 daggers, and Zerker's Greaves. He's got a lot of damage on this. You can see home guards from Seraph. Is he going to make it in time? It doesn't look like he's going to do it. It's going to go down.
Got it. The hop back as well to help clear just a little bit of distance and give that breathing room in. And Team Dignitas playing very well from the beginning of the match and continuously holding the strength. They don't put themselves into a bad situation. Kiwi Kid's not flashing forward into crazy instances because a kill looks like it could happen.
Well, it's a very safe bottom lane.
Very,
really safe.
Yeah, very measured, and it's working out for him.
The Black Shield, the Fates Call, TDK looking for this second dragon. Everybody on Dignitas is back right now in the base except for Shifter, who's got a little forward position on him, yeah. But they don't have the coverage for this at the moment. That's going to be TDK picking up their second dragon. And the gold is pretty much evened up now. Dignitas, they were down a little bit by about one turret, but they've got two back there because of that dive.
What will happen next? It looks like we have the teleport on Gamsu. TDK is heading towards the mid lane here. Wonder if they can get pinched off or if Gamsu has enough time to waltz over and make this happen. Looks like the team's just going to set up some defense for now. They don't want the fight that TDK is bringing to the table just yet.
And right before the fight comes out, we got to point out Seraph's Embrace not completed just yet, but he does have the Archangel Staff. We see the Rod of Ages.
It's very close.
Stacking up. It's
700.
It's very close. He's 50 away from it to the Trinity Force spike. But Aurelian needs a little more oomph behind that. He needs to get that Spectre's Cowl, keep himself healthy, because it's a double, triple AP threat here, considering a lot of magic damage from the Zac. And there he goes on to Baby.
Love what Dignitas is doing with their team here as well. The initiation from Azingi already made it. Kiwi Kid's actually thrown a Talisman of Ascension in there to keep the engages going if anybody gets popped out. They are ready to take these fights over and over again, as long as Core JJ doesn't take too much damage, as he is right now.
Oh, he's off
but
on the side.
They still
he's
want
pop
it. They still want it, even after seeing him go to 25% HP. A good dodge there by Bishu, and they get out alive. So just a Talisman of Ascension, too. Not too much burn there.
You know what I love about Talisman of Ascension?
What's that?
3/4 the way back up.
Yeah, exactly. Almost ready to use it.
It's a 40-second cooldown, and when you get those masteries, it's a 32-second cooldown now.
I'm so jaded, I thought, work with Free too much. I thought you were going to make a pun there. And you I'm really glad you didn't. I was like, am I going to get this? But I like it. See, it's already up. Talisman of Ascension. Very useful here for Kiwi Kid. If he's not going to be Flash Tibbers, he's going to be doing the safe run-in and then run out if possible. After he gets his bindings and soul shackle.
Yeah, Freak would have done something along the lines of, you know, Talisman of Ascension, it's very suiting because Azir's in the game. It'll help him out a bit. Ha ha ha. There we go.
That was Freak level. Thank you.
That was Freak level.
Thank you for fulfilling that. I felt like I had a void or something that was missing. Dragon still a ways away here as we see two in the favor of TDK, just about 27 minutes into the game. Dig is keeping themselves away from these fights for now until they get the one they want. They did have a bit of that early game lead, but they fear the poke. They fear the Bishu, and they fear the Latman right now because they could start this fight exactly like Core JJ was about to at about 25% HP.
Everybody's going pretty good builds right now. You see magic resistance prioritized on TDK's tanks across the board here. Even Baby is going for the Mikhail's Crucible.
Baby got back.
Get people out of Morgana Binding, save their lives. He doesn't have to go for the early locket because Kez has that already on him. Bishu with the Muramana completed, the CDR ready to poke up. And then Latman, he also has a Bloodthirster on himself, just like Core JJ. So everybody is hitting these spikes at the same time. The big one, though, is when Gamsu, he gets that Luden's Echo. He's doing ridiculous damage before. It's just going to be even more ridiculous now with that item, considering Ryze throws out so many spells during his supercharge.
He's already got the Wisp. He's hanging on that for now. Nice hail of arrows. A little bit of a slow field in that choke point, so Team Dignitas can't get through the barrel as well. Things to deter them. And Talisman of Ascension goes off. Only a Dark Binding. Azingi flies over the wall. Kez is going to be the first target they look at. Seraph's actually diving in to try and help. Gamsu a little too far forward. Takes the hits, but he's still alive. The Arcane Mastery and the Seraph's Embrace keep him alive. Kiwi Kid close to going down now as Azingi flies through with Shifter's Soldiers, and they can only pick up a few more bits of DPS. It is going to be Baby going down by the hands of Kiwi Kid as they continue to fight. A nice hail of arrows once again to keep Gamsu from getting back into this one. The Talisman of Ascension could be coming back up soon here. Azingi maybe with a slingshot.
It's up
this
already.
This is an absolute coast-to-coast fight right now. Talisman of Ascension once. Azingi going for the slingshot. It's not going to be in range, and the fight is finally called off by Dignitas as they make it
50% away up the lane.
They just get to chase them all the way down, and that's Baron in their sights. The TP back in from Gomsu because he didn't die the first time they engage on.
Crazy.
So low. Latman off on the side. He threw in the ward.
Latman!
Like,
one more!
Oh!
So close! Oh! That was a lot of damage coming from Shifter Soldier right there. I wouldn't want to stand still either.
Luden's Echo.
Chomping at the bit. Dignitas finally gets a fight that they want, and that was off the Talisman of Ascension. Kiwi Kid flying in.
You got to use it three times total.
Yeah.
Use it at the start.
It's like Rizal.
Chase them all.
You don't match a Rizal.
But chases them all the way down the lane, is able to use it again. But this right here, Gomsu. Seraph wants to kill him, flashes away. Woo! Gomsu gets out. One more hit maybe would have been enough there. Mm-hmm. And Kiwi Kid almost dies, flashes away. And this fight just trailing off. Baby, he's backing up. He's like, oh, but he was burning the entire time from Kiwi Kid.
That was a really nice hail of arrows to stop that. Not that it stopped everything they wanted it to stop, but it prevented it for a small amount of time.
Yeah.
Rise. Oh, okay. Just going to take your soul. Thank you. He gets out alive. Seraph says, I want that for a little bit longer, please.
Yeah, that's the first edge that Dignitas has had in this game, though, is off that fight and off of chasing them down the lane. And Dignitas talked about it. Shifter talked about it. That's how they're going to get this edge in this game. Mm-hmm. And I said at the start, if this team composition makes it to late game and they can get these team fights, they can break the siege with Zac, get in there with Morgana, and the Talisman of Ascension is just going to help them out even more in these team fights, starting them off against TDK, which wants to keep you at arm's distance.
Very focused in their dives as well. Or even dives, elongated fights, not doing things that would put them in a bad situation or disadvantageous. And they come out with a low death game, I should say. High kills in their favor because they're the ones playing it safe. Already been able to push up here the second tier of turrets, dropping the bottom one. They're going to have Core JJ clean up a little bit. A good spot for Dig to be in here. They have some breathing room. They can clear their waves and then set up what they want to do next. Aegis being built up as well by Kiwi Kid, so that's not going to hurt too much on the side of TDK. They don't have too many members that's going to stop, but still, they kind of have to boot items now. It's a surplus of what they can put in their inventory.
It's going to be very difficult for TDK to wrestle out of the situation, given just their composition.
Yeah.
It's made to poke, but Dignitas drafted very well for engage, also to get people out of the very little engage that TDK has. Mm-hmm. A black shield's going to stop people from jumping in on you, and the death charge, and if you happen to go on Kiwi Kid, you just switch it up with a Fate's Call. It's hard to get in on this team if they don't want you to get to them, but if Dignitas want to start a fight, there's no getting away.
I mean, already TDK is hatching this ward. All five members right now can be seen by Dignitas. This is a ward that was placed earlier, still not cleared out. Dignitas has been moving these forward, and I feel like if TDK is in any spot, they should just place flank wards immediately. One to your right, one to your left. Because that's where they're getting hit.
Kez is looking over the wall for some action.
Yeah.
He's going to actually ditch that position he was in.
See, look at Gamsu, left ward.
Yep.
Easy peas. Make sure your flanks are covered.
Yep.
So, TDK is there with their own for now. Moving into their blue side, they warded up quite a bit, as we saw on your screen. That's why they were able to make it out safely as Dignitas came through towards the dragon side. 51,000, I should say, to 47,000 now as we enter 33 minutes in. Dignitas has seemed to slow down a little bit. Can't get past the second tier of turrets unless TDK is not there, so they're going to have to do something tricky to make that happen. Wave clear is still pretty good for TDK.
That's the good thing for TDK, is they have a lot of wave clear and siege. You make it up to their turrets, they have Corki, they have Varus, they have Gragas Barrels to help clear them out, and then you have to think of the split push threat, Seraph, even though he's not that much of a threat anymore in this game. It's strange to say that a late game Aurelia is not a huge threat in this game. There's a lot of counter to him right now on this team Dignitas composition. You have multiple ways to get him off members, whether it's the Emperor's Divide, Azinghi using Let's Bounce, or just Gamsu soloing him out with multiple roots.
Right. Or you try to dive in, you just get a gigantic Emperor's Divide in your face, and then you can't get onto anybody. Going through some items. Most of the core items finished up now, except for that Luden's Echo for Gamsu. And he is holding on to about 300 gold, so still looking for a bit of cash money to get that in his pocket.
Yeah, they send him down to a solo lane to try and complete that item. His TP is up right now, so even if a fight does break out, he will be in attendance.
So just trying to get the poke out. You can see how weary TDK is right now. I wonder if once Dig does have those lanes pushed and they can start getting on turrets, if a Zingy just holding onto the slingshot is enough to brute force TDK off their turrets, if it's scary enough. We've seen that a lot when we used to say Meteos and other players on Zac. You just kind of use that strength of saying, I could come in. That's my turret.
I dare you to stay.
Yeah.
Just playing chicken.
So we're getting the split finally, though, as Irene. And it's actually going to be Seraph top, so they could have an option here.
And both top laners going to opposite lanes of each other. But this is a 3v4 in the mid lane here. This is really TDK trying to rely on the wave clear of Gragas and Varus just to keep everybody at bay.
All right, so Seraph was just getting kind of a punch on that top lane, so they get a bit of it in their favor. They won't have to worry about it for a little while.
Poke is still
good, though. Yep. Setting up the Azir turret. Shurima giving them a base outside their base in the mid lane. They can't hold it for too long, however, though. Dignitas knows an overstay could cost them, and they decide to back right now. 2 minutes onto Dragon, good timing on that, and a minute onto Baron will all... We'll put them all back onto the Rift in just enough time.
That's going to be Luden Zeko completed from Gamsu as he backs there.
Double Ludens now, too. So you're not standing anywhere safe. You're not going to get hit from some damage. It's AoE.
Two of them. It's almost like there's an Echo.
Oh,
boom,
man.
Freak level. We did it. We did it.
We did it.
He's on the desk in heart.
It was clean.
Soul. But anyway, moving on. The fact that Dignitas are at this position, 7-2, they're not finding their way into these fights, is just TDK having composition that just wave clears. I wish there was, like, TDK's playing it, like, really well. Well, they're not engaging. Kez is not jumping the gun. He's looking for the right fight. But the right fight involves Azir, Core JJ, and Gamsu, Shifter, Core JJ, and Gamsu being softened up by Bishu, which is a tall order for the arrow slinger there. He's got to be Legolas style. He's got to hit everybody multiple times before they start a fight or even get an objective more. Because Baron looks to be in the sights of Dignitas right now. And Azingi, he's doing what you said. There goes the start.
There's the strength. It's right onto Seraph. You cannot get away. Azingi has just turned it on here in the spring split for Dignitas, making moves that are really paying off for the team. And now it's up to TDK to poke the hell out of Dignitas and get him off this Baron.
Yeah, where was Baby before that? But look at this. Azingi's going to go back in on the Baby.
Bates call in. Eyes on Bishu and Latman as well to make sure they stay safe. Baby throwing it back. Also uses the Mikhail's on himself to try and get out, but he gets taken down. Core JJ gets the rend off. Kez comes in for a little bit of beef between the AD carries. And it looks like Dig's actually just going to answer it. Go back to Baron and make it happen. You got to remember, though, it's Latman and Bishu and Kez. They can all poke quite nicely. And look at the health of Dignitas here. This could be scary.
This is really scary, actually. The fact that Core JJ is going to be their primary source of damage. Kez looks like he might want to go in, or they're going to poke on the side and threaten going in.
Azingi's way too low. Oh. Baby Zac!
Oh.
Keychain Zac, get out! He's good. He's good.
Keychain Zac.
I think Kobe said that last week. I liked it a lot. So props to Kobe. Live on both objectives here on the map. Looks like.
Are they going to start themselves? They are going to start themselves. Here comes the TP, though, from Gamsu. They're going to pull out after that. They're going to try to collapse on him, see if they can do anything about it.
Nice hail of arrows again. Canceled. Doesn't really need to make it happen. The TP is up for Seraph, so he might be able to tend to a different lane. If that was even necessary right now, he can just go ahead and push mid. See if they can get onto Latman here. Core JJ making his way up, but that ward already going to see him. Flash for flash. Latman's going to have Valkyrie in the fight now, so that could be very dangerous for Core JJ if they get a good stick on any of those ultimates from TDK.
Just looking at the Luden Zeko rise, 431 base movement speed right
Why?
Now.
Why? Not safe for work.
Yeah. Merc treads, I assume movement speed quintessences, and then having the Luden Zeko movement speed on top of it, 431, and then when he pops his passive, or pops his ultimate, he gets 80 more movement speed. He gets to train down pretty much anybody on this team. And with the Merc Treads, he's a little bit harder to peel.
It's like Formula One rise. When you hit that ultimate, you're just off and running. Pole position. 38 minutes in. Seraph's going to be picking up third dragon here.
Which is good, because we just talked about movement speed. It's going
good
to get TDK.
That
TP
is up. Oh, he steals it! It's going to be Kez that takes down the Baron. Kiwi Kid's now getting hit. Fake call, pulling back in. Seraph distracting the team on the other side so Latman and Beast, you can get in with more poke, but they just want the Baron. They actually don't want the fight from what it looks like. They're out, and they're happy.
Little bit gratuitous there from Seraph. Was not necessary, but it looked like TDK wanted to pick a fight afterwards. That's going to put them, once again, 4K difference between these two teams off the back of Kez with a miracle save there.
He has been putting himself out there all game, gank after gank that did not work. One last time, he goes for broke. Baron is definitely going to help put Dignitas back in this game, help get their waves pushed.
I like that, though, because it shows that Kez, last time we saw him, he seemed very risk-averse on complexity.
Right.
Hashtag 80 minutes is the dream. Every time it was they could make a move, he opted to not make the move, and instead it was, no, give up the objective, back up. Kez seems like he's taking more risks for smaller payoff, but this is like a medium risk, medium reward, because he had Flash and Body Slam.
That was
he's like, I should at least try it.
I need to try it. The only other risk they've taken, because TDK
goes in.
Boom.
Boom! Body Slam and the Smite. 1,100 was the last number we really saw on that.
Yep. Able to pick up Baron, a little bit of map pressure, and hopefully enough room to get themselves back into this game for the TDK fans. Kez, a little careless here, taking down the Scuttle Crab.
Oh, speaking of careless.
A little far away from the family. I was going to say, they are able to meet with him, though, right in the mid lane safely enough. So, TDK gets the fight they want at Baron. It wasn't a flank. It wasn't what we expected. It was just the all-out brawl that Kez was able to steal Baron with. And now we'll see if they can get the fight 5v5 right in front of Dignitas.
This team composition with Baron operates fairly well. They want to poke. They want to get these very squishy members, Shifter and Core JJ, to a little bit lower HP before they engage a fight. Azingi, he wants to jump in, though. We'll see, because this composition, both of them are set up for wave clear situations. Mm-hmm. Shifter can clear these casters out very quickly. He can also clear the melees. Apparently, when you sweep the Azir turret, you see it. So it gave eyes back.
It's here.
Oh,
a Zingy over the wall. Let's
bounce.
He got
stunned, though.
He did get stunned.
Oh, he's back in.
Beginning flies through, and a Zingy tries to keep it in the fight. He's going down. The blobs are out. The passive is down as well, and that's a 5v4 now for Team Dragon Knights. But again, they are having hard hats on, and they are not going to go in under the turret. They make sure it's safe. They know they have Baron, and the wave was not too far off. Going now for the inhibitor turret. It does not look like Dignitas can do much. They're very, very low, and not too many members are even sporting home guards, so they have to stay here. They have to try and protect the turret. Inevitably, gonna watch this go down if they can get a few more shots, and it will be.
Baron wears off.
Baron has worn off. TDK are able to pressure through one more time. Gamsu getting the ultimate off, does not take down Kez, but that forces TDK off of the base. 15 seconds on a Zingy. Still have some time to wait. Oh, he flashes over the Chain of Corruption, but Seraph goes in with the same idea. They are thinking alike right now, but Seraph goes down first. That's the double kill for Gamsu. It's exactly what he wanted to be, the focal point that TDK came back on. And now only Bishu and Latman stand between Dig and the Nexus.
When you stay too long and you expect to get out. I talked about the movement speed from Gamsu earlier, flashing over the Chain of Corruption because he knows he's going to close that distance onto Bishu eventually. That's huge. Dignitas, despite not getting the Baron and flubbing the last few minutes with the Azingia gauge, they're still going to go even in turret trades, and they're still going to get this inhibitor on top of everything.
Gamsu with the balls to the wall play, flashing forward, knowing he had his Arcane Mastery close to up, plus the Seraph's Embrace, and nobody could chunk through that shield. Absolutely beautifully played there, and the team followed up. They knew it was coming immediately. I said, not a lot of people had home guards. Gamsu does.
This turret is well.
Now they all do.
Dignitas. Man, they didn't even get the Baron, and they're going positive on what they got out of that Baron being taken. Bottom lane, though, from TDK. Big minion wave on that tier two. It's actually, I think it's going to take that turret. It is going to take that turret down bottom. You can see here.
This chain.
Gamsu just,
nope. Woo. Thank you very much. Here's the shield.
Yeah, Seraph jumps in after that, and everybody's like, we got to save him. But no.
The shields actually get depleted immediately. It just looked like regular damage because they came and went. That would have been his entire health bar in the end. 1 minute on Dragon. It is number four, so should be stopped here by Dignitas because TDK could start to put their foot down with five.
When you stay a little bit too long for that turret, that's exactly what happens. And like I said in the previous game, it's a game of seconds at some points. If they don't spend those extra 3 seconds killing that turret, they are 3 seconds, 900 units further away from the rise than they would have been earlier.
Yeah. Seeing some more items come out now. Talisman of Ascension actually answered by Baby here for whether they're engage or disengage from what Shifter or Kiwi Kid can bring to the table with going into the fight. But Kiwi Kid has also put a Banner of Command in his inventory, having a little bit of extra gold here and not really anything else as he builds his way now to his items. Hasn't used the Banner of Command, I don't think. Still not on cooldown. But they have that option to force a wave and keep TDK focused on these fights, which they have been.
Yeah.
So they may not notice that minion wave.
Baby. Everybody's going towards this dragon. It's the fourth dragon. Like you said, that minion wave, not really noticed.
Where's it going?
Baby inspired by Kiwi Kid to buy the Talisman of Ascension. Very yep. late on that pickup. But still going to be enough. If they get this fourth dragon.
Oh, let's bounce. Two members, almost three now. Kaz on the back line, very hurt. There's a nice cast, but it doesn't really separate the team in the way that he wanted. It's Dignitas with the ability to still put down the DPS. Core JJ over the wall now, doing what he can to take down Kaz. And they will back off once again, measured in their attack and not going too far. Also, they're very low, so they probably would have tied instantly going in there. Smooth and well played as they do not force themselves into a choke point. TDK still trying to do things to keep themselves in the game. I like to see that they're not afraid to keep pressuring these things. Obviously, Fifth Dragon is going to be something that could put them inside Team Dignitas' base, so something that they have to continue to try.
It would be a huge swing if they were able to pick up that Fifth Dragon, delaying it even further.
Yeah.
Baron up
but now
in
they're delayed
a couple
even
of
further,
seconds.
Honestly.
It's true. It's very true. Speaking of delayed, though, the heal from 4JJ was used so Shifter didn't die to Dragon. Yeah. He got very low, and he's like, I have to fight this. I have to go in. But look at this. Kez is no longer around for a hero steal.
Oh, hello. No disrespect, just knowing that Kez isn't there, and there's not much you can do about it. Chain of Corruption comes out to stop Dignitas from moving off the Baron too fast. All the way over. Two gaps from the Baron pit. A Zingy hits up Seraph, but there's more members of Team Dignitas there, so his tenacity is through the roof right now, and he breaks out immediately as Aurelia. They're going to go ahead and head back to safety once again. TDK keeps scraping their way out of these fights. They're able to somewhat fight against Dignitas, but they never get too much out of it. Dignitas is eventually just going to break these inhibitor turns.
It's really the prep for the fight here for TDK. Even if just looking at the kills and the compositions, 14-3 in kills. TDK is still holding on, though, because TDK has a lot of wave clear. TDK is able to poke people down before fights, and that's how they've gotten so many objectives. They're only one turret down against Dignitas because they keep poking them out, taking an objective, poking them out, taking an objective. They're not getting the kills. They're getting people very low, but they aren't getting rewarded with those kills. And then Dignitas, their comp is all fight. They want to fight. They want to engage. So when you see TDK go for a dragon and not soften up the opponent beforehand, it's going to be a one fight for Dignitas because people are making out with just slivers of HP and they're able to be reckless against this composition that's all about poking. A lot of the damage from a Varus and a Corki is pre-fight. You soften people up. Inside the fight, though, their damage output in total drops because the fights are so abrupt in comparison to the pre-fight.
Would love to see them pull out what they did against Cloud9 now. Very close to the same score. They only died some four times in that game, but much more control over what happened at this point in the game. Already taking multiple inhibitors, finding their way through. Seems like TDK has figured out this Team Dignitas strategy here, and they're not having that as easy of a time zero turret win. Dignitas is not struggling with this one, but definitely being tested a little bit more here against the sub-squad of TDK, nonetheless.
Latman goes top. They lose a good portion of their wave clear. And they lose both turrets. This is all three inhibitors open.
Okay, so as I say, they were taking all the inhibitor turrets. They start taking inhibitor turrets. A flash from Gamsu locks down Seraph. Still, without too many members there, that Rune Prison is going to do a good lockdown onto Aurelia. And they start to finish off the inhibitor turret now. Get more super minions down the mid lane here. Baron, remember, is on to Dignitas. So the minions coming in are going to help even more. They already take down Baby. And it looks like Kiwi Kid once again forced out after his initial initiation. Shifter returning to the fight with a squad of super minions in the bottom lane. Or rather, minions that are baroned up. And they go for the fight. Whoa, Gamsu a little too far forward there. Puts himself in the fire and he gets burned real bad. But it's going to be the rest of the team. Shifter and Core JJ picking up kills and inhibitors for the team. As Dignitas finally looks to put, looks like they're going to put a stamp on this game. Inside the base of TDK and on some Nexus turrets.
Dignitas Not with the same type of early game of pressure that we were expecting. Azingi, though, having another good performance on the Zac.
He really is.
Extremely surprised with how he's performing this season.
In a way, if it's the thing that he can get the best engages on, like I said, the CLG Sejuani game he played wasn't that great. Maybe people will start banning out this Zac against Azingi since it's become so good with the team. Maybe even it was Dignitas that started working better with it as he leveled up his play as well. It's just all come together for Dig. As you can see, four members down and Seraph almost on the fountain as he's quite dead. Team Dignitas are going to take down Team Dragon Knights. 49 minutes.
Very low kill game there from TDK.
Once again.
High kill from Dignitas. They're really in a habit of starving their opponents. And the way they played that, it wasn't just draft. It was the way they played the map on Dignitas' side. The way they played the team fights around Azingi was well executed. The chase down top lane was the big play of this game that opened up the map off of Kiwi Kid's Talisman of Ascension run in over and over again. The relentlessness of this composition, when they see and they smell blood, they're like sharks. They will keep going for that kill.
Yeah. As well. Also stopping when they needed to. We did see that one fight in the top lane go pretty much from in second tier turret to second tier turret. Dignitas knew they had it. Definitely something that's different in their play. Very methodical, very measured in what they're doing. And like you said, low kill games, low death games as well. Only four deaths against Cloud9 when they played that matchup. Team Dignitas definitely looking better here in the spring split. For TDK, not much you can say other than hopefully this doesn't hurt it when they bring out the original main roster that they've been looking to play with.
It's hard to say original because they changed since they played in Challenger.
That's true. Not original, but the main roster they're looking to play with. Because they definitely seem like they can start putting some numbers in that win column once they get the full team. Kez playing with three subs. Not to say that three subs are bad, just naming them as three subs because it's a big thing to play with three subs on the LCS stage does not give you the team fight coordination, and that's 20 to 30 to 40 minutes is where we see a sub team fall apart. But what I'm getting at here is that TDK actually still look pretty good. So with that main five, they could be a threat.
The thing about this game, though, was they didn't put a lot of weight on Kez's shoulders or Seraph's shoulders. It was really a poke composition with an AD carry and mid laner. And Bishu, I have to say, did step up to the table. He has 50,000 damage this game. And I know that's the nature of poke champions. But you look at Latman, he's got less than half. He's got 23,000 damage.
Yeah.
And then you look at Shifter, who was also playing a champion like Azir, 29,000 compared to the 50,000 that Bishu did. So Bishu was basically the strategy of TDK, and it was ruined by that guy you were seeing there on your screen, Azingi, who kept getting those perfect engages on the back line.
Over and over, and especially we didn't even get to see them really bring it to a turret where I was saying maybe he'll just pressure him off the turret when Indignitas is big enough.
He just kept coming from the side and slingshotting himself
right
in, and then Kiwi Kid would Talisman of Ascension up the gut or come from the flank. It was really well executed there. Every time they were kind of looking for TDK to play into their hands, they did.
It was pressure that ultimately made TDK's defense go to the wayside. As I was saying, there weren't enough wards. They need to place one left and right. They actually had that in that blue side jungle, and TDK walked away from Dignitas in that instance. Fast forward 5 or 10 minutes, that kind of falls to the wayside. You may not have a ward as you move forward. Azingi flies over three or four walls, and the fight goes over. So Dignitas definitely keeping their mind in the game the full time. Better with a full squad.
Yeah, TDK
made it happen.
TDK kept their minds in the game. They were playing around the map, the poke, playing around that. And Kez with the steal was something I actually really, since it's a sub squad and they aren't expecting to get a whole lot of victories with it, the fact he's able to make those risky plays and say, you know what, I will go for this, seems very un-Kez-like from what we saw previously. So I'm glad we're seeing that from him.
Absolutely. Maybe big things for the team once they get that main roster. To share their thoughts on that match, let's send it over to our guy.